fourth.
Alright, everyone's homework 2 is graded. I just forgot to bring the folder of them with me in class, so if you're heading back over to the main building, you can stop by my office, pick up your graded homework 2. Homework 3 will be handed back on Wednesday at the beginning of class, and forget, homework 4 is due on Wednesday. There isn't going to be a homework assigned this week because of the midterm, so next homework will be assigned a week after on chapter 5. Alright, so so when we left off last Friday, we were talking about systems and control volumes. Right, we covered the material derivative as a way of moving between a Lagrangian and Eulerian representation of a fluid field. And systems and control volumes sort of followed the same logic. Remember, system is this Lagrangian concept. You say, here's a chunk of fluid particles, I'm going to keep track of these particles, no new ones, not getting rid of any of them. And I'm going to follow them through space and time and see how they interact with their surroundings and other objects. And so that collection of particles, call a system. Whereas a control volume is a fixed volume in space, and we see what happens inside of it as fluid flows through it. So the problem that we have is that all of the laws we have, F equals ma, conservation of mass and such, are written in a Lagrangian form. You know, you look at any of your rigid body dynamics that you've done in physics class, whether it's, you know, F equals ma, let's say trajectory of a baseball, right? Thrown baseball. Use F equals ma to compute how quickly it accelerates downward, right? But you can think of the solid matter making up that baseball as a system. Right? It's not getting destroyed. Nothing's getting added to it. It's a collection of particles. They happen to be solid, but same idea. So if I told somebody in here to say, well, apply F equals ma and figure out how fast this baseball is moving, this long after it's thrown in some trajectory, you could do it. However, if I told someone, just monitor this weird little arbitrary volume over left field and tell me how, hard the baseball was hit by looking at only this volume in space, then your first thought is going to be, what the hell's wrong with this guy? This is not a class on baseball, and this makes no sense. But we need to make it work. We need to have a way of relating these fundamental laws of physics given to us by guys like Euler and Newton and so on and so forth. We need a way of applying these to a framework that we can actually use in a fluid. And hopefully you understand by this point that a Lagrangian observation of fluid just isn't realistic. You're not going to keep track of the same group of fluid molecules as they flow down river or something. You need to stay fixed in space and observe things as they flow through a fixed point in time, or a fixed point in space. So this is what we're going to be, this is the motivation for what we're going to call the Reynolds transport theorem. And this is similar to how we derive the material derivative. Remember, the material derivative written as what we have on the left-hand side, this Lagrangian rate of change. Here we have our local term, and we have our convective terms, both of which are Eulerian sort of notions of change. And so this gave us a way of relating an Eulerian flow field with unsteadiness and movement through the field to the Lagrangian rate of change of a particle. So what we need to do is expand this idea to a control volume concept. So we need to come up with a way that allows us to apply F equals ma, conservation of mass, to this fixed volume in space. So, as I said, this is where we get into what we call the Reynolds transport theorem. So, once again, let B equal some amount of some property in the system. Okay? We need to make a distinction here between called big B and little b. Big B is what we call an extensive property. This is something like mass, or something that depends on the amount of actual fluid that you're measuring. Whereas little b is the amount of property per unit mass. So the mass has been divided out, and so it becomes independent of the size of fluid in which you're interrogating. So this is actually a pretty important distinction, because it's going to sort of pervade both the end of this chapter and the entire next chapter. So to go over this idea of, you know, intensive, extensive properties, let's do a couple examples. So we have B. Let's say we have mass. Kinetic energy half mv squared and momentum. All right. So these can all be thought of extensive properties. If you take a larger chunk of fluid, you know, a larger volume, the mass is going to increase. Same thing, larger chunk of fluid moving at the same velocity, both your kinetic energy and your momentum will increase. So to compute, to figure out what the intensive property is, that is, the amount of mass per unit mass, the idea would be you just divide this by m and you end up with 1, right? Easy. So kinetic energy, what's the intensive property form of kinetic energy? Let's go with, Michaela.
1
half V squared. Yeah. 1 half V squared, momentum,
V,
or the velocity, right? So easy enough, but just remember that like velocity is essentially momentum per unit mass. Dealing with 1 half v squared, it's the amount of kinetic energy per unit mass. This should all be relatively straightforward. But anyway, so what the. Okay, so if. B is equal to BM, then if you've got some volume, the way you actually compute the amount of B present in a system is going to be equal to the integral of the volume of the system of B rho dV. The idea here being that this rho dV is equal to d mass, and b delta mass is equal to delta b. So it's essentially just summing up all of the individual extensive amounts of this extensive property inside of the volume. So the Reynolds transport theorem tells us that the Lagrangian rate of change as the rate of change of some extensive property in a system can be represented by the rate of change of the extensive property in a control volume plus some flow rate of the extensive property out of the control volume minus the extensive property flow rate into the control volume. And it may look like these signs are reversed, right? It's weird to see plus b out dot out minus b dot in, but this is actually correct. And what we're going to derive is this relationship here. You don't need to worry too much about understanding this quite yet, but sort of in words down at the bottom. This tells us that the rate of increase of a property in the system is equal to the rate of increase of the property in a control volume that's fixed in space plus the net rate of efflux, that is flux out of, flow out of the control volume across its control surfaces. So, to put this sort of graphically, let's consider flow down this pipe here, right? So if we're counting, let's say, let B equal the number of particles, right? This is pretty simple. B, our big B is equal to the number of particles. So what would be the system in this representation, Noah?
Okay.
Well, then, if the system is a collection of all of the particles that they move through space, let's say we've got these particles flowing down the pipe. We've got this chunk of space taken out of the pipe. You have a notion of what would be the system in this representation?
The purple box.
Purple box.
Yeah. No, I guess the system is the, it's the four green dots inside.
Now, if we're interested in, I guess that's kind of open-ended. Let's say the system is actually equal to all of the dots.
Okay.
Right? All the dots on this is a flow that's on the pipe. That means that the purple box here, if it stays fixed in space, you know, so as these dots flow down, right, this purple box would be then be what? About a control volume, right? It's fixed in space, it's not moving. And what about the edges of the box here? Yes, control surface. All right, so here's our statement of the Reynolds transport theorem. Okay, it's telling us, again, that the rate of change of the number of particles, because big B is the number of particles in the system, it's going to be equal to the sum of the time rate of change and number of particles in the box, plus the number of particles flowing out of the box, minus the number flowing into the box. Now, identically, looking at this, are we destroying any particles, adding any particles? No. So we would expect the number of particles to remain the same, right? So this is going to be equal to zero. Let's step forward one time step. All right. Notice the box only has three particles in it now, so we've got a negative one in our time rate of change of our extensive property inside the control volume. At the same time, one particle is flowed out of the box here, so we end up with a one on our b dot out. Sum this up, we end up with a zero. Go forward another time step. We end up with one more added into the box, right? So we picked up another particle inside the box, we end up with a one in our time rate of change, and at the same time we ended up with one flowing in, so we get a minus one. Again, sums to zero. And so on and so forth. You see that right now nothing has flowed into or out of the box, and the time rate of change inside the box is zero, so we end up with zero. This is the idea behind a control volume versus systems approach, is that if you keep careful track of what's flowing into and out of a control volume, as well as what's happening in time inside the control volume, you can recast this into an understanding of what is occurring to, what forces are acting on, or what's occurring with the system as a whole, as it flows down some field. Let's look at a slightly more complex version of this. Let's see if I can get it up here. All right. So, this is basically the same demo, but it's this nifty flash animation that, if I can get it to Alright, here we go. Same notion. The purple box here is our... If I play that one more time. The purple box would be what? True volume. How about this blue box here? This could be our...
System,
right? It's moving with the flow. So if we're calling B the mass of all of the particles inside this blue box, that would be our system representation of mass, right? And so if we went through the trouble of counting up all the particles, what we would see is that inside the purple box, we have some change in mass of negative 6. We've lost 6 particles out of the box. And 6 particles have flowed out of the box, and 16 have flowed in. So we end up with a difference of 6, which of course sum to a 0 net change in the particles inside the blue box. It's a simple enough concept. It's just a matter of bookkeeping. So, go ahead and, and the same thing applies. You know, I mentioned that B can be any property. For example, if we're talking about momentum, now this animation's gonna add up not only the mass of the particles, but their individual velocities. And we would see, once again, we went through the trouble of individually computing the momentum of each of these particles and seeing how much goes in and out, we would see that we end up with a zero net rate change. Okay, so come on. All right, derivation time. So how do we get the Reynolds transport theorem? This is a classic derivation here. It says, imagine we've got this diverging pipe. At time t. And let's go ahead and say that we've got let's go ahead and take this volume here as our control volume. And, you know, the system can be whatever collection of particles we want it to be. So at time t, let's go ahead and say that the system is also the collection of particles that just happens to be inside the control volume at this instant in time. That's the system at time t. Down at this end, we have some velocity v1. At this end, we have some velocity v2. So, at time t, this tells us then that the volume of the system is equal to volume, the control volume, and that B in the system is equal to B in the control volume. It should be, this is just, you know, we could, as I said, we could pick the system to be any group of particles we want. We get to tell it's this particle, this group of particles over here, but that wouldn't be very useful because it never touches the control volume. So for derivation of the Reynolds transport theorem, let it start out this way. Now, at time t plus some small advance in time, Material volume has not moved. But the system has, right? How far has this left-hand boundary of the system moved, symbolically? Well, V1 times delta t, right? Because this area is larger than this area, so V1 and V2 are not equal. Remember, diverging pipe. But yes, so we'll go ahead and call this delta length 1, which is equal to V1 delta t. Similarly, on this end, it has gone some distance. DL2, which is equal to V2 delta T. So our system is now partly contained in the control volume, but not entirely. All right. So what we're looking at here is now basically we've got these two overlapping sort of trapezoidal volumes where we could say let me get consistent with the color here. So if we go ahead and label the different sort of regions, these volumes, let's say that, let's call this one, let's call this region, God, I am not getting lucky with the markers here, let's call this region two, and then this region right here, which is sort of shared by the two of them. Well, we can see, you know, we can say a couple things about this. We can say that this is equal to the system minus area, the system minus two, or we could say it's the control volume minus one. Let's go ahead and say that this is our control volume minus region one. All right? We've got one, two, and now CV minus 1 is what's contained in both of them. All right, so what this allows us to do is, let's go ahead and, so the extensive property, whatever it is, B, we're not going to specify what it is here, at t plus dt is going to be equal to B cv t plus t minus 1 at t plus delta t. plus V2 T plus delta T. And relative to the time, and let's go ahead and say that this is plus. Let's go ahead and say that relative to the time here, this is the extensive property inside the system has changed by some delta B. So to solve for delta B, we of course just simply subtract the side from over here. And what we end up with is then delta B is going to be equal to let's do this a long way. B system at time t is equal to B CV t minus 1 at t plus B 2 at t. At time t, over here, is there any volume contained in regions 1 and 2? Yes, no, maybe. No. I bet. I hear a no. That's right, because the two volumes are coincident. So, zero, zero. So if we want to compute delta B, which is equal to B T plus delta T minus B T, that is system. And we just subtract, you know, each element in here. So we end up with it's equal to B C V T plus T minus B C V T minus B1 T plus delta T plus B2 T plus delta T. All right, so let's figure out what this B1 and this B2 are made up of. So, let's finish this, I guess, first. All right, we go ahead and multiply or divide both sides by some delta t, all right? What does this begin to look like? If you've got the difference between something at two instants in time divided by the change in time between them, if you take the limit as delta t goes to zero, calc 1, it's just a derivative, right? T equals delta t minus state of t divided by delta t. So what we end up with is that delta b delta t is equal to, or starts going towards, because we're talking about the system, we use capital B. It's equal to time rate of change t minus starting to look a little bit like the Reynolds transport theorem, but let's take it a step further. I'm going to go ahead and erase sketch. All right, time rate of change of B1 and B2 are the what we need now. So let's say, of course, in shorthand, we call this B dot in, and this is B dot out, right? So one is the amount of fluid that's flowed into this control volume, two is the amount that's flowed out of the control volume. Those are quicker ways to write it. So let's look at this B dot in term. Well, let's say that at the inlet here, if this is a very small little slice, we can assume constant cross-sectional area. So B1 without a dot here, it's going to be equal to the integral over volume 1 of rho b dv. And this volume is going to be, so it's going to be b is equal to rho b A1 times delta L1, right? This is the width. We're saying this has some cross-sectional area A. Done. Which is equal to rho B A1 times V1 delta T. This is, of course, a very small quantity of B, so we'll go ahead and include the delta. And so if we say delta 1 over delta t, we end up with rho b a1 v1. Take the limit as delta t approaches 0, and we end up with b dot in. So this is just telling us here, and this shouldn't be too hard, is that the rate of flow of our extensive property, big B, into the control volume is equal to the, remember, rho b, or, you know, b is the amount per unit mass of this extensive volume. Rho a v1 tells us the mass flow rate across this boundary, and so we end up with is the mass flow, or the flow rate of this extensive volume, or extensive property, into the control volume. Similarly, if we say rho b A2 V2, this gives us B dot out. All right, so for the case of, you know, the one-dimensional flow down this expanding pipe, our Reynolds transport theorem can be written in full as minus rho A1 V1 plus rho A2 V2. So if the velocity is steady, right, if you pick any point in this pipe and the time rate of change is equal to 0, then, you know, we could say that this term goes to 0, right? This is our Eulerian representation of the flow unsteadiness. This is the unsteadiness at a fixed point in space, and what we end up with is simply a flow into and out of the control volume. But remember that when we have a confined flow like this, our conservation of mass says that A1 V1 is equal to A2 V2. So these two things would cancel out as well, and you end up with a zero net change in your system. All right. If this were unsteady, if the flow were unsteady, then what you're going to have is some change in the system property, which is simply equal to the control volume. So did you have a question? Okay. So this is a very idealized system. This is about as simple as the Reynolds transport theorem gets. What we're going to do next is a more general form. Okay, so this is what we just came up with. Right? The same derivation we just came up with, rate of change of the system, sum of the rate of change inside the control volume, plus flow rate out of the volume, minus flow rate
so
in.
It wouldn't matter if the plus and minus were switched on the board, is that? Minus flow rate in, plus flow rate
minus in. Minus flux in, plus flux out. Same here, actually. Minus in, plus out. It's just different order.
Okay.
Right. And this is one of the harder things to keep straight, and it's one of the more common mistakes is to want to say plus flow rate in, minus flow rate out. But the idea, remember, is that you're tracking the system, not the control volume.
Okay.
So what flows into the system, into the control volume, has to displace what's in the system. All right. What if we have something that looks more like this, though? Say this is our control volume, and our system is now this black boundary. Well, we end up with the system flowing out of the control volume. We have some slice that is now in the control volume but isn't the system, one. Some bigger slice that is in the system but no longer in the control volume, two. But you know, we don't have this clearly defined notion of where our inflow and outflow boundaries are. We don't have an outflow area or velocity, inflow area or velocity. So these terms don't work anymore. So if you have confined flows, you have things in pipes and such, then you know, this form will work great. But we need to take this one, we need to generalize this even further to work for cases where you have non-ideal control volume shapes. So the idea here is that now, instead of, you know, before we were assuming that you could just, we had some constant velocity normal to an area, but that isn't always the case. In fact, let's take this three-dimensional sort of surface area element, okay? Let's say that this is some component of, can I have the eraser on it. So let's say this is your control volume. Yeah, let's make this a weirder streamline. Okay. So if we take a look in, this is the outflow. So if we consider this boundary right here, right? This little, we zoom in on this spot where flow is occurring out of the volume. You can have a velocity vector which doesn't align with the normal unit vector at this spot. At the same time, it's only flow normal to the surface that actually transports this extensive property across that surface. And so with some, in some delta t, you know, some small time step, what you end up with is that the amount of extensive property carried across the surface is equal to, you know, the same rho b, and now velocity dot, time, with dotted with the normal vector, times the delta t for the time step, and then multiplied by the small element area. And so over the entire surface, everywhere where outflow is occurring, it's going to end up being the surface integral of just this term, you know, delta t has been carried over. And you end up with that, let's say, everywhere that flow is occurring out of the volume could be kind of written, could be highlighted in red here. Okay. And we could say that V dot out is equal to the integral over the out portion of the control surface. V dot N rho V VA. Now, is this clear? The way we've generalized the flow across of a surface area that isn't just normal to the flow itself. All right. Same idea with inflow, right? I'm out of colors. Let's go ahead and make inflow this. Portion here, right? Anywhere the flow is occurring into the control volume. Again, by convention, the normal unit vector always points out of the volume and into the fluid. So in this case, we end up with the small influx of our extensive property is equal to negative because of the fact that normal and velocity vectors are in opposite directions. V dot N, that is the component of the velocity normal to the surface area, times rho b, the amount of extensive property per unit, unit volume, and then delta t and delta a to give you the small volume that's transpired across the boundary. So b dot n ends up being minus, because again, the alignment of the normal vector and the velocity vector, the surface integral over the, this is supposed to be in. That's my mistake. One moment. Okay. Over the inlet surface of this quantity. So it looks much the same as this, but we end up with B dot N equal to CS in rho b v dot a. So what does this actually let us do? Well, let's imagine now we've got, it's again this weird-shaped control volume where we have inflow on this side, that is some velocity flowing in, doesn't necessarily align with the normal vector everywhere. Velocity out doesn't align with the normal vector everywhere. So we end up with our B out and B in terms. If we actually combine these two, we have our CS out, CS in, negative signs cancel, and we end up with, so we have the integral over the outlet surface plus the integral over the inlet surface with the same integrand. Let's quickly take a look at, what do you think happens in this little area here? Right? If we have an area where there's no, the velocity is actually tangent to the surface, the control surface. Well, if that happens, then we have no flow across the control surface, right? That's the idea of tangency. And so in those cases, this V dot N would equal zero. Because you have an N pointing out, it's orthogonal to the velocity vector at those points. And so those go to zero. And so what this allows us to do is simply write this integral over the outlet surface plus the integral over the inlet surface as the integral over the entire surface with the same integrand. And so this now is our final version, our final generalized version of the Reynolds transport theorem. The integral over the control volume of rho b, time rate of change, plus the surface integral over the control surface of the rate of flux across the control surface. So just like we had in the material derivative, remember there was an unsteady term and a convective term. Same thing applies here. It's got a lot of parallels between this and the material derivative. Eulerian time rate of change, time rate of change inside the control volume, was a convective rate of change. The time, the amount of, you know, the rate of change caused by convection of fluid across the control surfaces. So, why is this important and why does it matter? You know, why do we care about the Reynolds transport here and we're just showing blobs of fluid floating around? It's important because this allows us to do a lot of very powerful mathematical analysis of fluids, and this is where you're really going to start computing dynamic properties and dynamic forces on fluid bodies. So if you take any control volume of finite size, it can be infinitesimally small, it can be huge, as long as you know the boundaries of some control volume. You can do an analysis without knowing the actual details within the control volume. For example, especially if it's a steady flow, I should say, if it's a steady flow and your ddt of what's going on in the control volume goes to zero, then all you need to do is know what's happening at the control surfaces, right? Because the entire thing is just made up of your control surface integral. And for example, if you compute, if you say that B is equal to momentum, right? It's a vector quantity that is mv. And you compute the time rate of change in momentum, you end up with ma, right? Which is equal to a force. And so if you do a control volume analysis of the flux of momentum in a system, this is what allows people to analyze things like water jets and jet engines. It's because you can take a sort of a preview of what we'll be doing in the next chapter. Let's say you have B is equal to momentum. If you've got something like, say you've got a jet engine, right? And you're in the airplane, and you're seeing this jet engine relatively fixed in space, and you see a steady inflow, assuming steady state operation, and you want to know how much thrust this jet engine produces, all you need to do is, you know, climb out the window and install velocity probes here and here, but, If you were able to measure the velocity going into and out of the engine, right? If you know rho, in this case, you could calculate, you know, if B, big B is equal to mv, then we saw before that little b is simply equal to the velocity. So if you plug in the velocity in here, a vector quantity, and we say steady state, this goes to zero. And because this is mv, the time rate of change ends up being ma, you know, which is equal to the force applied on the system of fluid traveling through the jet engine. Then we can actually calculate the thrust produced by the engine just based on the velocity going in and the velocity going out. The rest of it can be a black box. So this is what's really important about the Reynolds transport theorem. This shows us how to compute the forces acting on a Lagrangian grouping of fluid, a system, based on the quantities going into and out of a Eulerian representation of control volume. So, as I said, I know I keep reiterating, but my hope is that it will stick. Reynolds transport theorem. The time rate of change of some extensive property of a system, Lagrangian. Second term, time rate of change of the extensive parameter within the control volume. This is an Eulerian concept. It has to do with the unsteadiness of the field, flow field. And three is the net rate of efflux, the outflow, the extensive parameter across the entire control surface. And again, the reason we're able to group the outflow and inflow properties is that the direction of the normal vector takes care of the sign for us. If it's inflow, then you end up with a velocity being in the other opposite direction to the normal, so the dot product will have a negative sign. If it's tangent, there's no flow across, then because of the orthogonality of the normal vector with the streamline, you end up with zero cross flow. And if it's an outlet, then your v dot n will be greater than zero. So I kind of already showed you this example more or less, but the things that the Reynolds transport theorem lets us do also depends on the flow that we're considering. For example, if we have a purely steady system, one like I showed you there, where you can cancel out this partial derivative with respect to time and the control volume, then what this tells us is we can treat any control volume as a black box and only monitor what's going into and out of it. So in a case like this, we may have some control volume where flow is only in the x direction going in, but has some y component going out. And so by conservation of linear momentum, we could show that, well, something has to be happening to the fluid in order to direct it upward. And by computing this rate of change in momentum going in and out, we get the force acting on the fluid, and we can show that this, the actual direction and magnitude of the force acting on the fluid. And so you could compute, for example, how much power you have to deliver to a pump here in order to direct the fluid upward, or how much lift is created. There's a classic way of doing analysis of wings and propellers is by of doing analysis of wings and propellers is to say, here's a wing, here's inflow, and then what happens is it directs the streamlines downward. And so if you put a control volume around your wing, it looks like this, and you look at the amount of momentum in the y direction at the inlet and the outlet, you can actually compute how much lift is being generated by the wing. If you have a system that is purely unsteady, let's consider this case flow through a uniform pipe or flow through a non-uniform pipe like the one that we derived first, where conservation of mass says that this will go to zero, then all you have is that the rate of change of the system is equal to the rate of change inside the control volume, because if it's uniform, like this, then any thing that flows across one boundary has to flow out across the other. And the fact that the cross-sectional area is constant means that there's nowhere to pick up a convective acceleration term. So a little bit more on control volumes. There are cases when we don't want our control volume to be typically we want our control volume to be as simple as possible, right? If we're going to be analyzing this thing mathematically and doing integrals over the surface of it, we don't want it to be all weird and strange shaped and moving all over the place. But in certain cases, it is convenient to have our control volume moving. This is an example that is kind of a classic case where you say, hey, let's put some vane on a cart and let it move with some velocity and then blow a jet of water at it and see it direct the water upward. What is the force on the vane? So if you assume, as we will do frequently in this class, that your control volume moves with a constant velocity, that is the cart, you can actually do this pretty easily. The trick is recognizing that now the convective rate across the control surface is no longer the velocity of the fluid. It's the velocity of the fluid minus the velocity of the cart. It's, in a sense, like the encounter velocity of the fluid with the control surface. And so just by vector addition, if you say that the total velocity is equal to the relative velocity plus the velocity of the control volume, then it's this W term that finds its way into your convective rate of change in the Reynolds transport theorem. Okay. This is a analysis, this sort of a simplification of what you might see with propeller blades, for example. If you can take a slice through a propeller blade and see that, just like in this case, it redirects the flow and creates thrust as a result, but is also moving through space, you may choose to make your control volume moving. So there are a couple of things to consider when choosing a control volume. And this is going to be something we put into practice a lot more in the next chapter, because the next chapter is control volume analysis entirely. It's applications of the Reynolds transport theorem to control volumes. So lots of practice. Don't worry. But if we want to know a property at some point, you know, usually it's easiest to measure properties at the boundaries of a control surface, or boundaries of a control volume, that is, on the control surface, because the convective term about a control volume in a system. I mentioned that one of the big advantages of the Reynolds transport theorem and control volume analysis is that it lets us treat everything inside this control volume as kind of a black box. If you want to maintain that level of convenience, then one of the things is you don't want to have to measure things inside the box. Because of the inclusion of this term right here, the control surface, we have to know everything that's happening on the surface. So if you want to know a fluid property, it's convenient to pick your control volume so that the point of interest is on the control surface. So it's already showing up in this term. If you really want, you know, you could pick one like this. This is perfectly valid. You'll get the same answer. But this requires you to know everything in detail that's happening inside the control volume, which you wouldn't otherwise have to know. At the same time, you could pick a weird control volume. You know, this one's interesting. It has the point on the control surface. But now your control surface is weird, or you're weirdly shaped and is nowhere orthogonal to the velocity vector. And so it makes this term, your convective term, a lot harder, because you can't simplify your surface integral any longer. You have to do the actual integrals and the volume, or the velocity across each of these surfaces. But the point to reinforce here is that these are all valid. You can make your control volume anything you want. They'll give you the same answer. But there are choices that can make and break your ability to easily compute the answer to fluid problems. So, all right, up to this point, any questions? Kind of blew through some of that. I think it's a lot quicker than I learned the Reynolds transport theorem. Well, then at this point, we're just going to work through a couple of examples. I think we probably have time for about two of these. Only one I wanted to go over. So these examples were actually supposed to be saved for Wednesday's lecture, but it looks like we're going to be finishing up this chapter like a day early. So if it's okay with you guys, my thought is that Wednesday's lecture time, instead of beginning the next chapter and then having to go back and review it all the following week, we'll basically start doing the midterm review session during the normal lecture hour on Wednesday. And then any overflow will be immediately after in the Rosenblatt room. So if there are more questions, people want to work more examples, I will be in the Rosenblatt room from 11 to 12:30 on Wednesday, in addition to class time. On that note, for Wednesday, I mentioned before, I'm not planning on making it a super structured review. If you have questions from the homeworks, bring them. If there are questions from the lectures, bring them. And I'll try to put together a list of sort of example problems that we will work through on the board. And that'll be the format. So, example one, Reynolds transport theorem. Say that water enters the bend of a river. This is a river here, with some uniform velocity profile, as shown. At the end of the bend, there's a region of flow separation, or reverse flow. You know, this could be thought of as where, you know, the river turns a sharp curve and you end up with a recirculating kind of eddy that goes on. See it all the time around rocks, for example. There's a fixed control volume, A, B, C, D. Coinciding with the system at time t equals zero. So what we're asked to do is A, make a sketch at the system at some time 5 seconds after the snapshot here, right? And B, make a indicate on the sketch the fluid that has entered and exited the control volume in that time period. So we're making a drawing. What is the one thing that by definition does not change with time? Stays fixed between system and control volume, right? Which one of those doesn't move? Control volume. So let's start by drawing the control volume because we know it's the same 5 seconds later as it was at time t equals zero. Here is uniform. How far do we think the boundary of the system moves downstream in 5 seconds? That is, we know that the boundary of the system is going to move downstream by some distance. We'll call this dx1. What is the distance delta x1?
5 meters.
5 meters, right? Uniform in flow, 1 meter per second. Divided by time, so we end up with 5 meters. All right, at this end, we have a non-uniform velocity profile, right? But if we're assuming that this is unsteady, or that this is steady, then the point that was at C, right? Let's go ahead and these 4 points here. We'll call this little a, little b, little c, and little d. How far does particle little a travel downstream? I heard a couple answers. Right, the velocity at point C is 1.2 meters per second. So in 5 seconds, it'll convect downstream 6 meters, right? How about point little b?
6 meters.
Also 6 meters, right? We've got A, B, C, D. Also 6 meters. Good. Point C. Little c right here. Well, right here,
oh,
the velocity,
oh,
it's a zero crossing, right? So it's not going anywhere. So that's going to, and at D, sounds like Joe already had the answer there, 5 seconds, it's going upstream, right? It's reversed flow at half a meter per second. So that means this is going to go 0.5. So the blue outline here is now our system 5 seconds later. Okay. Now what has flown or what has flowed into the control volume in this time is pretty obviously given by everything over here. Inflow and the outflow from the control volume, well actually anywhere else there's inflow occurring. Maybe down here in this segment, right? And outflow would just be this region right here. This is the bulk of fluid that's been convected out. Red is the bulk of fluid being convected in. All right. Clear? Any? Put this one up here and give you guys just a couple of minutes to sort of get an idea of what your individual responses to A, B, and C are, and then we'll go through those. We're all done with this sketch here. I'm going to go ahead and add a D, which is sketch the system at time t equals 0.5 seconds as well. Oh, and the system. My bad. You're right. I should probably read the question. Okay. All right. Anyone have an idea of what our control volume is going to be? Between the plunger, so I mean, this may be easier if we talk in terms of control surfaces, right, which bound the control volume. So You're saying that the plunger is one control surface, and the upstream control surface would be
like the end of the nozzle.
Like here, or here.
By the end, because like that's where the velocity
is measured
from.
I mean, in reality, either one would work, right? The control volume can be anything you want. You can make the control volume this right here, and that's valid, but it's going to be a pain in the ass. So, and then the shouldn't be too much of a surprise that the boundary's here. Okay. So, what is maybe non-classical about this control volume? How does this control volume vary from the cases we were just doing? Yeah, it's a deforming control volume, right? As the plunger gets depressed, this control surface is going to move. And so your control volume is going to shrink in time. Why is this a good choice? Well, hopefully that's fairly obvious. You have the fluid at the boundary of the on one side of the control surface and not the other. And so you can actually calculate the force being applied to the plunger as a function of the momentum flow rate across this control surface only, because there's no momentum flow rate across this control surface. Okay. Part B, make a sketch to indicate the control surface and system at time t equals zero. So I guess we've already sort of done that. If this is the control surface, the control volume is everything contained inside the control surface. And the system at this time could simply be, again, we define what the system is, but we'll go ahead and say that the system is the same group of fluid particles inside the control volume at time t equals zero. Okay. Now, alright, now in 0.5 seconds, how far has the plunger moved?
0.5 meters.
Right. And we've already established that our control volume is deforming, that is, the control surface follows the boundaries of the plunger, right? So this control surface has moved 0.015 meters from its original position as well. Now the system is a little bit more, well, it's not terribly complicated, but we have the flow rate out of the end of the syringe, right? So push the plunger, the fluid that was originally inside spurts at the end here at a rate of 5 meters per second. So how far has the rightmost boundary of the system here traveled in half a second? 2.5 meters, right? So not to scale, I suppose. 2.5 meters. Okay. Aren't any questions on this or the stuff we've done up to this point? I had this example, but this is actually one of the homework problems, so we're not going to do that in class. But that wraps up the Reynolds transport theorem, material derivatives, fields, chapter 4. So, you know, what did we cover in chapter 4? We dealt with the idea of fluid fields, right? Field representation, which is a way of expressing fields, which is a way of expressing a fluid parameter as a function of space and time. An example being the velocity field. And example being the velocity field as a function of position and time. We dealt with the material derivative, right? Oh, also, this being an Eulerian concept, right? Because we know it at fixed points in space. We dealt with the material derivative. Which is a way of computing a Lagrangian rate of change from known quantities in a field. An example being the acceleration, which is equal to so from field measurements of the velocity, unsteadiness, and convective rate of change, we can calculate the acceleration in a Lagrangian frame. So Lagrangian, Eulerian. Sticking with the Lagrangian Eulerian dichotomy, we talked about systems versus control volumes and control surfaces. Systems being groups of particles flown through space, and control volumes and control surfaces being, for example, an arbitrary volume bounded by a control surface. Okay? Systems are allowed to move, time, fixed identity, they can interact with stuff. Control volumes stay fixed in space, regardless of time, if it's undeforming. If it's a deforming or moving control volume, whatever. But the idea is we know the location of a control volume in time and space. And then the Reynolds transport theorem, which told us that the rate of change inside a system some extensive property is equal to the rate of change, the unsteadiness of that extensive property inside the control volume, which we'll go ahead and write out in its integral form, CV rho B V plus the surface integral of rho B. Which allows us to compute the rate of change of an extensive property of a system as a sum of the rate of change of that extensive property inside the control volume plus the rate of flux of that extensive property across the boundaries of the control volume, which are the control surface. And so hopefully the kind of progression here has been clear. It all comes down to using Eulerian notions of fluid to compute Lagrangian concepts. And the reason for this is because, as I said, all of our fundamental laws of physics, things that Newton and Euler wrote down, conservation of mass, conservation of momentum, MA, stuff, all applies to groups of fluid particles that stick together, right? Systems. But we don't like following systems around when we're doing fluid experiments. So we use things like control volumes, where we can put some sensors in one spot and leave them, and use the information we gain to infer stuff about how the system is behaving. And by doing so, apply things like F equals ma, by doing rate of change in momentum to a system, right? And turn that into the flux of momentum across the control volume of the surfaces. So that wraps up chapter 4. Again, I have graded homeworks. in my office. Drop by if you want to pick up your homework two. Otherwise, I'll bring those along with homework three on Wednesday.
It's
scary.
But it looks like it's so good.